Chapter 13. Aircraft. 1957. About 2 years ago, Robin said an aircraft would be useful in this area, and then asked if I would be prepared to go in with him if he did get one. I told him that I was not interested, nor had I the money at that stage. In due course, a strip was made which extended between Robin's farm and Brian Freyberg's. As they were operating together, it was obvious they were going to share a plane, although Brian had not done any flying. Soon, a Piper Cruiser arrived, with one seat at the front for the pilot and two in the rear, sharing one seat belt. This was a very good work aeroplane for the farm. It could have done with a little more power at altitude, but was a very useful workhorse, and we were all very envious. Brian was getting daily lessons from Robin and the Nairobi Flying Club, where he completed his course and flew the plane back to the farm. Shortly after that, George Carr took delivery of an aeroplane. It was a Cessna 172. He was not to be done in the eye by the new boys. He wrote that off on his airstrip later that year. Now almost everyone was buying aeroplanes. The only ones left out were a few who had never taken up flying, and myself. I was being continuously nudged by Robin and others, saying, "For God's sake, get a plane, you need one, you can't carry on without one." Then one night, when Robin was having dinner with me, he asked me to go as his guest to the annual RAF dinner in the cruiser. It meant going off on Saturday morning to Arthur Cole's at Moega and returning on Sunday, which suited me very well. I don't know what got into Robin. He must have bought half of Moega and kept loading things into the plane until I thought it would never take off. However, we got off the ground and back to the farm with no trouble, with the nose facing the sky most of the way and the tail dragging. But we managed to creep over everything. I thought to myself, if this plane can carry all this, I could do with one. My choice would be the same type and model, so I asked Bosky if he was thinking of selling his plane, and he said it was for sale at £1,300. I told him he had a sale on condition that he taught me to fly. I gave him a deposit and arranged that he would take me up at 4:30 that afternoon. When we landed back on the runway, he said, with his very strange accent, "Why waste my time? Why did you not tell me you can fly?" I told him that I had not flown since I was in the Air Force and wanted to start from scratch again. "Well," he said, "you are wasting my time. I will put you in with Mr. Tuckwell." I stayed in Nairobi that night, and next morning I had a quick flight with Tuckwell, who had taken over as my instructor, and then went home, where I stayed for a week. After this, I returned to Nairobi, doing my compulsory 40 hours before I could get my license. I did my first cross-country to my farm strip with Bosky. After 2 weeks in Nairobi, I sat my private pilot's examination, did my flying pass out, and left with my aircraft and my license. With the exception of Piet Hugo, no one in the area knew that I was getting a plane. I had to leave the plane on my strip as I had not yet built the hangar, and a couple of days after I returned, Brian Freyberg came and asked me whose plane was on my strip. I replied that I didn't know, and he said, "It's been there for several days, you must know." I started laughing and he said, "You haven't gone and bought yourself a plane, you so-and-so." My aircraft did not have a radio or any direction finding equipment, and I had to do virtually blind flying until I got used to picking out landmarks. After a little practice, I had very few problems, except for one occasion. I was flying to Arusha and should never have gone over the hump between Mount Meru and Monduli. I managed to see a little place where I could creep through along the main road, but unfortunately everything was dark amongst the hills. Due to my past experience, I was able to stay the right way up, but apart from that I was in a bit of a mess. The area was extremely hilly, and I was flying very close to the road, which was almost enclosed by the hills. At one stage I was so low that I almost had to make a forced landing in a field next to the road, where there were prisoners working laying a pipeline. Suddenly I saw a little gap over on my right where I could see light through, so I made a beeline for it, got through, and was then more or less out of the hills. After I landed, I sat in the plane for almost half an hour outside the control tower thinking things over, and realized that I was being an absolute bloody idiot and ought to pull up my socks. I had got to the point where I thought all my old training would get me through anything, forgetting that I had no instruments. This experience did not do me a lot of good, as it had very nearly landed me in a nasty situation. Sometime later, I flew to Namanga, where there was a particularly bad airstrip, very, very short. On landing, I had a very interesting experience. There was a Maasai dressed in his Maasai clothing. He stood on the wing of the aircraft and said, in English, I'm going to look after this aircraft. How much are you going to pay me? I said, that's fair enough. I will pay 5 shillings. That was the going rate in those days and was quite a lot of money. If we did not want to pay, we would taxi through the town on the main road and leave the plane in the police lines. Then another Marseille came up and said he would look after the plane for 5 shillings. The first chap said, once again in perfect English, no, I'm going to do it. I turned to him and said in Marseille, which I speak, look, my friend, I know you speak good English, but I can also speak Marseille. This aircraft is not going to be handed over to you. He put out his hand and said, touché, and we went over to the pub and had a drink together. On my way back to the farm, I had with me a fellow named Ken Hammer, who was about to become one of my managers. He and I were at the Namanga Hotel, and he had drunk a considerable quantity of Carlsberg special lagers. On the flight, he asked me to stop somewhere, because he could not hold his bladder any longer. As I could see there were no vehicles for miles on the road, I landed, we both relieved ourselves, and just as we were about to push the plane back onto the road, a bunch of Marseille came along. They wanted to know what we were doing there, and we had quite a lot of fun with them. Ken was really intoxicated, out of his mind, and I too had drunk one or two too many. Otherwise, I probably would not have landed where we did. When flying into Wilson Airport, there was a beacon near a spot called Impala Point. Without a radio, and if the weather was good, you could fly directly to this beacon, fly over the tower, and receive instructions for your landing. If the weather was bad, though, or you didn't have a radio, the only way you could go in was to head for the smoke coming from the cement works chimney. Then follow the little stream which leads to the beacon. Another rather unpleasant experience I had with the cruiser was when I was in Mbulu and there was a landing strip inside a bowl-like crater. This was at about 7,000 feet. It wasn't a very long strip, but well maintained. I landed, took on a load, and then started to take off. I just could not get out of the bowl. It seemed as though the aircraft did not have enough power with the load, and eventually I thought I would have to land as the engine was heating up. Luckily enough, I got into an updraft, which lifted me sufficiently so that I could point my nose down towards the Rift Valley and get up some speed. At a later date, and in another aircraft, a similar thing happened to me when I went to look for somebody on Lake Natron who had been reported missing. I was flying a Cessna 180, which was a powerful plane, but it took me about 5 minutes circling around, with the engine getting warmer and warmer, before I managed to lift the plane enough to get over the edge and out. Another occasion with a cruiser, I had with me Lady Wyndham and one of my drivers. I had picked them up at Amboseli, and we went to Namanga for a beer, and to show Lady Wyndham what the hotel was like. As we landed, the wind was against me. I was going towards the road and there was a strong crosswind. Unfortunately, I got caught in a whirlwind, which lifted me up as I was about to stop and pushed me across the road where there was a ditch. The airscrew hit the ditch and got slightly bent. Something had to be done, so after having a good look at it, I consulted with Pat Gethin at the Namanga Hotel, who kindly offered what help he could. He gave me a vehicle, so we drove to the plane, removed the airscrew, took it to a tree, and with a hammer and a gunny sack, we slowly straightened it. I filed off the little edge that had been damaged, replaced the prop, and tried it. It seemed all right, so I took off alone, landed, and did a few more adjustments. After a second takeoff and more slight adjustments, it ran smoothly with no vibrations. We did all this with a hammer, a fork stick, and a gunny sack. Whilst I was doing these repairs, there was a German ex-Luftwaffe pilot with 6 or 7 tourists who kept telling Pat Gethin to forbid me to fly the plane, telling my passengers not to go with me. Eventually, I took off alone again, and the aircraft was perfectly all right. I then suggested to Lady Wyndham and my driver that they should stay where they were. I would fly home and send a vehicle for them. It was over 100 miles from the farm by road, but as the crow flies, it was about 20 minutes. Both of them said they would come with me. So I first did a couple more circuits with no trouble, and they jumped in the plane, with the Luftwaffe pilot going absolutely mad. He said I was dangerous, I shouldn't be allowed to fly, and he did actually report me to the Directorate of Civil Aviation, but this did him no good as I had reported to them immediately I landed. Kampling and van der Velde sent a mechanic to the farm with Mr. Street, the engineer, and a nice new airscrew which was installed. The old airscrew was taken back to Nairobi, and after a time I was offered a price for it, as it was in good order. I did not sell. I kept that airscrew until I left Olmalog. My wife Pat became very keen on flying. I had given her quite a few lessons. She was, in fact, capable of going solo with no problem, but as I did not have any instructor's license, I would not take her through this. When Harry Gandy was stationed at West Kilimanjaro airstrip on spraying work, Pat decided she would learn. We drove down every afternoon for about 4 days, then on returning one day in our Anglia on Mr. Wallace's farm, I was driving a bit fast when a cow came out of a sage bush straight across the road, and I hit it. It was, naturally, Mr. Wallace's best cow I had injured, and injured seriously. It had a broken back. My car was also badly damaged. I saw Eddie Wallace, the son, and asked him to bring a rifle, as the cow would have to be destroyed. He said he would bring the gun, but that I must shoot the cow, and I would be held responsible for the accident. Eventually the cow was shot, and to cut a long story short, we had a few words, and where they should have been able to claim on their insurance, they never actually got the money, because I described the case as it really was, instead of claiming responsibility. This incident was seen by Pat as a bad omen, and put an end to her flying. She wouldn't even take her medical. It was a shame, as she had done her solo with Harry Gandy, and would have been a competent pilot. The paperwork would have been no problem to her at all. The cruiser did me very well, but eventually I bought a Cessna 180 from Pyatt Hugo, which had quite an interesting history. David Lead, a wealthy Sisal baron, had recently imported this plane from the United States, and had promised his wife that if he had the slightest accident or mishap with it, he would sell it. He had to keep this promise very shortly after he got the plane, in fact, after only 20-odd hours flying. Whilst landing at Serenera on the Serengeti Plains, the wheel went into a pig hole, and the prop was slightly damaged. He managed to file off the end to get back to Nairobi, but when his wife heard about this, she made him stick to his promise. My friend and neighbour, Piet Hugo, had told him that if he ever wanted to sell the plane, Piet must have first refusal. Lead put on a new prop, slightly faster than most others, and when Piet took delivery at the purchase price, less costs. When Piet had done about 120 hours flying in the 180, his mother and father-in-law came to visit and flew with him. They did not like the 180 because it had a tailwheel, and they couldn't see the ground when they were landing. Next day they flew in a 182 with a nose wheel and told Piet they would buy him one if he would sell the 180. As the 180 was his wife's plane, she agreed to this and phoned me to ask if I would like to buy it. I had already flown in it and knew what a lovely plane it was, so quickly agreed. I got it for the price Piet had paid less 10% and less the costs of bringing it from the States, on condition that he could also use it until his new 182 arrived. This was a great bargain, and was the only non-governmental 180 Cessna imported direct. I believe it is still going strong in Nairobi, having flown nearly 3,600 hours in my hands alone. I put it on its nose twice, once on account of sand at Wasin Island, and another in mud at Endenahai. At Shimoni I was alone, but at Endenahai I had Sue Pretzlik with me. I sold the cruiser to Bishop Winter, who unfortunately had it for only a few weeks, when he wrote it off trying to land on his own strip at Dereda. I was given the altimeter from this aircraft, which I still have to this day. Chapter 14, Cattle Markets and Boats, about 1958-59. Due to improved weather conditions, the quality of grazing and waterholes in the area improved the general condition of cattle throughout. The demand was also going up. More local butchers and traders from different areas were appearing, and the buying pressure on the few head available was increasing all the time. At the same time, more buyers were trying to get in on the market due to the previous lucrative history of cattle buying, so I decided I would pull out from most of the trade and only cover certain organisations until they could find somebody else to carry out this work for them. This meant what was a fairly low source of income for me was being reduced even further. Some time previously I had started a pig rearing program, which was now doing well. It was managed mostly by Julian Lloyd, who was proving good at farming, but was certainly no mechanic. On the other hand, he was a very good ham wireless operator, which quite often came in useful in emergencies. I had gone to Nairobi for spares, and also to see a large consignment of pigs through grading up at Upland's bacon factory. Whilst there, I met up with a couple from our area, and we went out for a dinner together. The husband got very drunk and abusive to his wife, Mary. She and I had been keen on each other for quite some time, but did nothing about it, despite the husband having an affair with another woman. I gave them a lift back to the Norfolk, and as they got out of the car, Mary asked if she could come back to her home with me the next day, as she didn't want to stay in Nairobi for 2 or 3 days. Her husband replied, "You can go anywhere you bloody well like, as long as you leave me alone." Next day, on our way back, I asked Mary if she would care to come on my next short safari with me for about 3 nights. She replied that there was nothing she would like better, but she would have to bring her 10-month-old child and Aya. I told her that would be no problem at all, Aya being the maid. 2 days later, I picked up Mary, child and Aya, and we went off to Ngorongoro, where I booked 2 bandas and accommodation for 2 staff. I left Mary with the child and Aya and went off to Endulen to do my checking. I returned fairly late and went straight to my banda for a bath, and shortly after, Mary came and joined me with the child. We then moved to her banda and the Aya left. Mary fed the baby and put her to bed. We started to fondle each other before Mary broke away to serve a meal which had already been prepared. As we both seemed to be more in the mood for lovemaking than eating, I started undressing Mary until she was completely naked. She then said it was her turn and that I should get onto the bed while she undressed me. It was quite obvious by now that we were both very aroused, so as soon as all my clothes were off, we waited no longer, and with very little foreplay, we had quick and simultaneous orgasms. After resting a little, still in each other's arms, we thought we should eat, so had our dinner without bothering to dress at all. We made love twice more that night, and at about 3 a.m, I got dressed and went towards my own banda, but I stampeded a small herd of zebra, which I thought were buffalo, so I returned to Mary's room where the door was already open. At 5 a.m, I left the warm bed with Mary in it and went back to my own cabin. As we had a very sleepless but delightful night, we were both very tired, and Malambo was a very long way. I persuaded Mary not to come with me, as she would have to bring the child. I told her that I would get back as soon as possible. I managed to return by 4 o'clock, and as soon as I arrived, Mary helped me with my shower and had tea ready. I had a short sleep, then joined her in her cabin, where we had a lovely meal and another very active and satisfying night. Next morning, we left Ngorongoro reasonably early after a good breakfast and proceeded to Karatu, where I checked on market activities there before continuing on to Arusha, where I booked us into the new Arusha Hotel. Next day, after doing some odd jobs in Arusha, I delivered Mary to her home. Her husband had not yet returned. When I next saw Mary, I asked if she had told Mike that she had gone to Ngorongoro with me. She said she had, and that he didn't seem too care a damn, so as far as she was concerned, we could go off whenever we wanted to. About a year later, Mary and her husband parted. He went off with another woman, leaving her to make her own way. Afterwards, she and I had many good times together. My workshop was the weakest point on the farm, as it was lacking a good mechanic. Pat Townsend had come to the farm to convert my Massey Harris combine from an electric table lift to a hydraulic table lift, and had left a young mechanic with me for a few days to make sure everything was in order. This young man turned out to be a first-class mechanic and was looking for employment, but I would not employ him until I had spoken to Pat. It appeared that he was only temporarily working with Pat whilst one of Pat's mechanics was ill, and Pat wanted to find him a job elsewhere. I was delighted to take the man on. As I had discovered, he was a really good mechanic, but he had one bad habit. He left his tools all over the place and treated them as if they were of no consequence. He was also a poor organizer, but otherwise he was a trustful man. After 2 years, he asked me if he could look for employment elsewhere, as he wanted to get more workshop experience, and I replied that if he could get a job, he was welcome to go. After about 2.5 years with me, he left and joined Sembe Engineering in Moshi, and I was able to get a French mechanic who had already applied for a job with me some time earlier. My wife Pat had just returned from England, and the next day there was a great panic. An aircraft had been circling the Londorosi pyrethrum growing area and eventually crashed into the forest. Immediately neighbours came to my farm, picked up Pat and all went off to Londorosi. On Pat's arrival with all her medical equipment, she found Ray Palfrey, the pilot, the brother of Arthur, sitting down drinking a brandy in the manager's home. He had a few light scratches and was obviously suffering from shock, but nothing more serious. I had purchased a small 14-foot boat with a 25-horsepower Evinrude engine on Lake Duluti. Good fun on Duluti, but no good on the sea. So I sent for plans from New Zealand for a Harley 21-foot boat, and in my spare time I built this and a trailer to take it back and forth to the coast, which I found very easy to tow behind my Ford Bronco. The boat turned out to be a good and lucky boat, winning some prizes at fishing competitions. When I was about to launch it at Watamu, a friend and his wife had screwed on the side a board with the name Master Beta 2. This name stuck until it was sold. One day at the Kalifi competition, a lady taking orders for sandwiches came up to me and said, "I needn't ask you, as you will no doubt be fishing alone." This incident drew a great deal of laughter, and to many I became Mr. Master Beta. One day I was working on my boat when up came the Locust Control Land Rover to tell us that the Desert Locust Control Organization had arrived in the area with aeroplanes and a considerable amount of bait. Most of the farmers were given lectures on how to deal with the hoppers as soon as they came up, and we undertook to deal with our own area as far as the hoppers were concerned. 3 days later, when we had all forgotten about locusts, my wife Pat called me out on the veranda and said, "Look at that huge dust storm coming towards us. It seems to be creeping. It's unusual, as it doesn't look the usual sort of dust storm from Amboseli." I immediately rang the fire bell, which called everyone to a mustering point, and asked Pat to go to the nearest telephone, which in those days was 16 miles away, to ring the locust control. They were between the post office and us, but difficult to reach by car. She should tell them there was a huge locust storm heading directly for the Olmalog farms. Meanwhile, I organised my staff with tin cans and fires wherever there was young wheat, which I thought needed protecting. It was about 3:30 in the afternoon when the first locusts were seen on the farm, and the spraying aeroplanes did not arrive until 5:30, during which time the locusts had set into all my fields and some of the other farms, which were all either just about to stall at the stooling stage or just past stooling. By the time the aircraft arrived, the fields were literally cleared. Up to this time, my farming had been doing quite well, and I had nothing to complain about. However, when I went around the farm, just as it was getting dark, the locusts had also started moving and settling on the forest just behind the house. Luckily, my wheat was still quite young, and the locusts had cleared all of it. As it was early in the rains, I decided to buy more seed, replant, and take a chance on some of the land, as there was still time for a crop if the rain continued. That night, the aircraft sprayed the forest, where we had seen the locusts settle. There were two planes going back and forth for about 2.5 hours in the dark, and they did a very good job. Early next morning, the first thing I did when I woke was to have a look at my fields. The whole farm was completely bare, apart from a few flowers and plants around the house, and one small patch of pyrethrum seedlings for planting. The whole place looked like a desert. At the back of the house, looking towards the slopes of Kilimanjaro, the green that had existed the day before had completely disappeared, and all the trees had the bark and leaves eaten off. The forest looked as though it had been sprayed with silver paint. I have never seen it look so beautiful. Sadly, I did not have an effective camera to capture this sight. I was still inspecting my farm when Piet Hugo came along. He said, "Gosh, mine is bad, but I think yours is much worse. What are you going to do about it?" I said, "Well, having seen it all, I think the only thing is to harrow everything in and plant on top of it." Piet turned to me and said, "David, once years ago I saw a similar sort of thing on a farm, and I would advise you to wait a day or two before doing anything like that." This turned out to be very good advice. As soon as I had breakfast, I went first to the forest to see what the kill was like, and we found that over almost the whole area where they had rested, there was a 4-inch thick layer of dead locusts. There were still a few swarms, but very few. Later in the morning, I went to West Kilimanjaro, where I ordered enough seed to plant up 150 acres. I was lucky to get this amount, as naturally there was a great shortage. Everyone had done their planting, or in the process of doing so. On my way back to the farm, there was a very heavy rainstorm, which caused the roads to be impassable for 3 days, so I was not able to bring up the seed to the farm. After 2 more days, Quanga, my headman, came to me and said, "You know, Buana, our wheat is going to survive. It's growing again. In some places, when I looked this morning, I could see rows of it coming up with the sun on it." Then I started looking around, and sure enough, most of the little shoots were coming up again, and by that evening there was already 90%. By the end of the week, it was all growing beautifully, including the plants that had started stooling. In a fortnight, the whole area which had been badly affected by these locusts and where very severe damage had been done looked as it had before the locusts. Luckily, only 3 or 4 farmers had fields that were sufficiently advanced to be able to have any real damage. All the younger wheat survived, and in my case, some fields gave the best crop ever. I did have good crops on many occasions, but that crop gave an average of 14 bags to the acre, Better still, I did not have to spray again as most of the weeds had been broken down, and they did not grow fast enough to compete with the wheat. I had no weed expenses, so it was in fact one of my cheapest and best crops. One farmer, unfortunately, had a mature green crop of wheat, not a large area, about 50 acres, but he lost the whole lot because the stems were still green and the locusts ate them all. We did find that if the wheat or grass was brown, these particular locusts were not in the least bit interested. I did have a pair of green socks drying on the clothesline, and these were attacked. Occurrences such as this do seem to have both a good and bad side. In this particular case, the locusts were dealt with very efficiently, and they did me well. One bad effect was that the poison used, I think parathion, also killed off many birds, particularly birds of prey. Some farmers did have to replant, and in these farms the wheat was much later maturing. We had been having some trouble with the crops being damaged by wider birds, and in particular by quailia, which were much worse as they came in very large flocks when the wheat was just about ripening. Those farmers who had to replant had very late crops, and the quailia more or less cleared them out. These birds were becoming quite a problem with us, and something had to be done. Up to this time, the government agricultural people had done very little about quailia control, so we tried as much as we could to obtain funds and contributed ourselves towards some sort of control. We had many meetings to discuss how we could go about trying to get rid of these pests. One suggestion was that we should fill 44-gallon drums with stones and explode them. This was in fact organized, and we were ready to go, but first had to find someone with a dynamiting license. We did eventually find someone, and the exercise was set in an area where we knew the quailia were roosting. The drums were exploded, but sadly it was very expensive and inefficient exercise. We then tried the drums with rocks and diesel in them. Again, not successful. Then we tried diesel with a small quantity of petrol. This was more successful. Sometimes we could get 1 or 2 million birds at a time. Unfortunately, many birds did not die on the spot, but were very badly shocked and burnt, which was cruel. On the third year of our experimenting with the quailia control, the government stepped in and produced money and assistance. They started with our last method, which had proved to be the most successful, but then introduced aeroplanes. Two of the people that worked in our area were Alec Noon and Harry Gandhi, two well-known spray pilots. Their job was fairly hair-raising because all our airstrips were just ordinary grass strips. We had to light them with hurricane lamps. Many of the areas they had to spray were gullies, quite heavily wooded. In the daytime, before the birds arrived on the scene, we had to place hurricane lamps on the tops of the trees so that when the planes flew over they could see the heights. Most of the birds concentrated in small areas from 1 to 10 acres. The preparations prior to the actual spraying were quite expensive in the early days, especially on dark nights, as we had to have lights all the way round, also on top. And we also had to have large controlled areas where people couldn't enter for about 14 days, as the parathion was very toxic. Anyone moving in had to wear gas masks or special clothing. Later, a new preparation called Quailia Tox was used, and by this time the government had started a quailia control organization similar to the locust control. They decided it would be best to get the birds at source before they invaded the farms.